Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and I'm here today at the Rock Island Auction Company. Now, this gun, by the time you see this video, has already sold, but it is a very cool, literally one-of-a-kind gun, and I didn't want to let it get away without getting a video on it. And it's a pretty good example of the sort of unusual and interesting things that come through auction houses like Rock Island. So, this is a conversion of an AR-180. It is a prototype rifle developed by a guy named Ross Rudd, R-U-D-D. Mr. Rudd was born in Toronto in 1915, but when he was just 2 years old, his family emigrated down to the U.S. They moved to Springfield, Massachusetts, took up residence there, and Rudd was interested in firearms design from a very early age. There's this cool anecdote about him where, you know, a lot of people as kids, like, I'm going to write to an astronaut or write to a sports guy and, you know, get a... you know, ask them something, and you get this cool handwritten letter back. And as a kid, that's really neat to have that piece of communication from someone you look up to. Well, when Rudd was 16, he got the idea for a better bullet design, and he sent this idea off to the U.S. Ordnance Department and got a letter back from none other than Townsend Whelan, who had evaluated his idea and wrote him back and politely explained why it was completely infeasible, but was impressed with Rudd's idea and, you know, and his diligence in following through on it, and invited him down to the arsenal and gave him, or Springfield Armory, and gave him a tour. And that was Rudd's equivalent of getting a letter back from a, you know, basketball star. Anyway, when World War II broke out, Rudd ended up moving to Chicopee Falls and went to work for the Savage Company, where he would work for a couple years. He was involved in manufacture of the Lee Enfield rifles for British contract, as well as the manufacture and the simplification of the Thompson gun. He had something to do with that, which makes sense considering where he would go later with some of his ideas. After a couple years, he joined the U.S. Army Air Corps, was in the Air Force for a little while. After the war, he got into aeronautical engineering, but still weapons related, did some weapons design for like the Comanche helicopter in the 1970s. And then ultimately, what we're getting to here is in the early 1970s, he finalized an idea for a new firearm locking system, created his own company called Rudd Arms, and got to work designing as well as an independent inventor this time. He started with a pistol, but then adapted his design to a rifle as well. And that's what we have here, is his one-of-a-kind experimental conversion of an AR-180. So let's take a look at the system he came up with. As an experimental gun, this is a little bit incomplete. You can see here it has no handguards on it. However, that's actually valuable for us to note because there's no gas system. What Rudd came up with was a delayed blowback operating mechanism that would work both in pistols and in rifles. So what we have here is an original standard factory AR-180 lower and Rudd's own handmade upper. I've said this before, but I'll reiterate it. If you are an arms designer and you want people to know that you made something, a really good way to do that is to put your name on it. And Rudd certainly did that in nice big letters here. So at the time, he had moved to Northridge, California, and that's where this was constructed. Now the interesting bit is inside here. Note that it's also missing its charging handle, but we won't let that stop us. I am going to pop this and pull this pin, and we'll get rid of the lower assembly because it's really not relevant. Now with the upper, I'm gonna go ahead and pull our bolt carrier out because this is where the magic happens. So Rudd's system here uses a bolt in the center here and a bolt carrier. In his pistol design, he had a bolt, and in place of a bolt carrier, he had a slide, like you would expect on a pistol. But rifles don't have slides, so you have this second part here. There is an angled surface at the back of the bolt, and there is a recess cut in the top of the receiver, and you can actually see it here. This is not totally unlike the recess, the locking recess in a BAR. And you can see that screwed in place so that he can replace this locking plate. He can harden it properly, and then if it wears or if there are problems or if he wants to retime it, because this is experimental, he can pull that plate out and replace it with a different one. So the idea is when the gun's in battery, this triangular wedge is locked into that recess in the upper receiver. When you fire, this starts to push back, and it's going to push against the upper receiver, which is going to tend to push this down. Now, the breech face can't move forward like it does here. Instead, the bolt carrier is going to slowly move backwards once you fire. So this comes just slightly backwards until this is all the way down, at which point the bolt carrier is free to reciprocate backward, extract the empty cartridge, and do the whole cycle. What Rudd did is engineer this to the point that it's actually, to me, the closest analogy would be HK's roller delayed system, because we've got the same idea here. With the angled wedge here is at just the right angle so that this will unlock slowly enough to let chamber pressure decrease to a safe level before it actually pulls the brass out. So if this angle is too steep, the bolt won't cycle. Most of the energy will just be absorbed into the upper receiver, and nothing will move fast enough. If this angle is too sharp, the bolt will open very quickly, and potentially when pressure in the brass case is too high as it's being extracted, and the case will explode. Same thing applies to HK's roller locking. If their wedge is at the wrong angle, either one of those things will happen there as well. So, but what Rudd did was adapt this with a single angled surface into a rifle as well as a pistol. So I can take his bolt apart very easily. The recoil rods act to prevent the bolt from coming out, but I can tip that up, and there is his bolt mechanism. The firing pin is held in place by one of these pins, so it won't go too far forward or come out the back. This looks like it started as an AR-18 bolt carrier, but has been heavily modified. It's got a firing pin transfer right there. One of the cool elements of this is, because of this tipping system, if the bolt isn't up and in battery, the firing pins don't line up. So when they do, the firing pin will come forward. But if this is even down a little bit, you can see even there the firing pin moves, but it's not long enough to actually protrude out the bolt face. And when it's all the way down, the firing pin they don't line up, and so you can't fire out a battery. So that is the entirety of Rudd's delayed blowback rifle design. And as with many things, its simplicity really kind of is an indicator of its quality, I think. I have not had a chance to shoot this, and I won't on this filming trip, but someone is going to end up with this rifle, and it would be really interesting to know how reliably it works and like what the bolt velocity is when it goes backward. It's, in a way, it's too bad that Rudd wasn't able to find a company interested in further development on this, because this is the sort of system that really does potentially have some future to it. Unfortunately for Rudd, as an independent entrepreneur, the firearms industry is a particularly difficult one. His pistol was set to like premiere and release in 1983, and they had big plans. They wanted to, like, the first 2,000 pistols were going to be made with titanium slides, and then they'd introduce, they'd go to steel after that and then introduce aluminum later, and he had big plans for it. And unfortunately, he was just unable to find any major manufacturer who was willing to take on the project. There's a lot of investment required in developing a new firearm for production, and he never did find a company that was willing to bankroll it. So with his pistols, only one prototype was ever made, as far as I know. And there is actually an old video up on YouTube that was moved over from VHS tape of Rudd himself demonstrating his pistol. So I'll link to that at the end. I'd love to get my hands on it myself for a video. But until that time, you can check out Mr. Rudd himself explaining it. And of course, there is this one rifle as well. So hopefully you guys enjoyed the video. This rifle has already sold, but of course Rock Island has all manner of cool stuff coming up in their April premiere auction. You can check it all out on the catalog through their website. Thanks for watching.